Welcome to the third episode of Coach Me Up. Today, I'm here with Tyler Williamson here at Legacy Barbell in the Woodlands, Texas. And I'm looking forward to what we've got going on because I get the feeling I'm going to get the full brunt of what it is that you do.
Yeah. You'll get a pretty good understanding of, you know, how I approach training. You're kind of wanting to live vicariously through what I do.
Yes.
So, It'll be interesting because, you know, we do a lot of the same things, just a little bit differently, because you have a different focus and I have a different focus.
Yeah. So let's talk a little bit about that. So tell me, give me some of your background, man.
So, I mean, I guess in high school I was like most people, coaches. They played sports and things like that. I was pretty good at football. But I decided that like track and field was like my passion, where I wanted to excel in, and it's kind of crazy because that's like other sports punishment. It's like running track,
right?
You're in trouble. Go do sprints, yeah. You know. But ended up getting a scholarship at the University of Texas at San Antonio, and from there I excelled to an All-American in long jump. And like at one time I was ranked like 5 in the nation. I was on track to compete with the U.S. Olympic team, but I tore my ACL. So I decided, you know, that was the end of the road for college athletics for me. And from there I was thinking at first I wanted to be like a college strength conditioning or coach or a track coach. During the time of my rehab, I ended up like helping my roommate, and I did some boot camps and stuff like that for the local fitness company, and started really enjoying the general population training because I got a lot of self-gratification from it, like being able to help other people besides like people who are just focused on sports and athletics. So did that and then decided, you know, okay, well, I didn't get this position that I really wanted out in Missouri. So I was like, well, let's go try this for a while, and ended up in Cyprus with my mentor, Heidi Johnson. And she, you know, super great mentor to have, you know, at the time, 20-year professional.
Wow.
You know, like just endless certifications behind her name. I think she's on like the board of directors with like the CFCS, NFCA, stuff like that, or the what's the other one? Not the it's the college coaches, CCA or whatever, college coaches association, whatever. Yeah, something like that. There's so many of them, but anyways, yeah. So you know, you go to college, you learn the foundational components of anatomy and phys, biomechanics, all that stuff, and you know, you come out, you're like, oh yeah, I know what I'm talking about. I got this degree, I got this paper, you know, that tells everybody I know what I'm talking about.
Right.
And you know, you get with a 20-year professional, like, yeah, you don't know shit, bro.
Right.
You don't know anything. And so, you know, I found myself like humbled pretty quickly.
Yeah.
So I stayed with her for about a year, eight months to a year, I forget how long it was, but learned so much they just don't really teach you in the classrooms. And from there I was like, okay, you know, I never really saw myself working for someone else, you know, so like I do it as long as possible to get what I need out of it.
Yeah.
And then I was ready to start going off on my own. So, you know, I went off on my own and started coaching athletes for sports performance there for about a year.
With the current demographic you're training now, I know you went from athletes to more general pop. Mm-hmm. Is that generally where you're living right now? Do you have a mixture?
I have a lot of mixtures in my training. Generally speaking, I'm a strength coach at heart. So in some capacity, I like to prioritize strength. That's where my certifications lie. That's everything that fascinates me about weight training is strength. With that being said, not everybody needs to have a big three.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, not everybody needs to barbell back squat. Not everybody needs to bench press. Not everybody needs to, you know, deadlift in a certain capacity.
Sure.
Everybody has the tools that they need to create the responses they're seeking.
Mm.
You know, and a lot of times, we were talking about this before we even started the interview, So like a lot of times you'll find that like power lifters do certain things very well that bodybuilders don't do. And there's certain things that bodybuilders do very, very well that powerlifters don't do. And I think it's good to try to, like, you know, bridge those gaps as much as possible. And with Gen Pop, that's what you're really trying to do the most. You're trying to find, all right, this person has this issue, okay? And how can I best and most effectively address it?
Yeah.
You know? And also have this person feel good as well. You know, if I took Gen Pop through what I do on a normal basis,
mm-hmm.
most of them wouldn't last.
No.
You know, it's been years and years and hours and hours and hours of doing the things that I've done in the past that got me to the point I'm at now.
Yeah.
So with that being said, there's a huge mixture in the clientele that I work with. I have a lot of people. Mainly the focus is getting stronger, but the movements, the tools I use is dependent on the person.
Sure.
You know, because everybody needs their own tools. Would it be great to have everybody being able to back squat, bench press, and deadlift, you know, without pain? And great. But I always like ask myself this, like, is it the most effective way to create what these people are needing or wanting?
Yes.
You know, sometimes it's not.
Right.
I've had very, like, for women example, who come to me and say, Tyler, I want to build a butt. Well, you know, people think, oh, but you should deadlift. I've got way better results from unilateral training for glute development than I ever have from deadlifts. And you look at EMG studies and things like that and get all sciencey with it, but unilateral training for the glute muscle is the most effective measure for hypertrophy reasons. Just there's more activity, it's more stimulation. And then we run into, okay, well, I'm not a big advocate of, like, I know there's a lot of people like training versatility, but I don't look at that in terms of like exercise selection a lot of times. I'm more simple. I find an exercise that's very effective, and I hammer that exercise as much as possible.
I love
that. And it's not always through overload. I'll find other measures like time and retention, and I can manipulate that given exercise, maybe offset load. I can manipulate it by what tool I'm using for that given that exercise, and I can utilize that movement pattern, that exercise in many, many, many different ways, and get better results than doing any kind of deadlift for that example right there. The same thing with like chest development. When I work with my bodybuilders, I rarely do flat bench. To me, it's one of those things that it's like, if I'm going to dedicate time of an hour of my time that you're paying for, I'm not going to dedicate it to an exercise that's less superior to like maybe something with more range, more chest development. It's like an incline, like a dumbbell or something like that. So you're always playing these like, these games of, all right, this is the person I'm with. These are their goals. Now, I like bench press.
Right.
That's great. I'm not them.
Right.
We have different goals.
Yeah.
So you kind of have to adapt, and you know that comes with experience. It comes with time, and as coaching many, many people. I, in the beginning of my coaching career, wanted everybody to do the things that I did.
Yeah.
I still have that a little bit.
Sure.
But it's like,
yeah.
I understand there's certain people that it's like, that's never going to be their focus.
Yeah.
So, you know, let's do things that they're going to feel successful at.
Yeah.
And that they're going to see results from.
Well, I love that because, you know, building success does breed success. And no matter what the exercise is, if someone can accomplish it, improve on it, and gain traction and momentum, it's only going to benefit them long term. And you touched on a few things that I personally think are just so important, and it just speaks to your experience and your wisdom as a coach. And these are things I've arrived to, as well as I'm much less concerned with being right and much more concerned with getting it right. Right? And it's easy to get married or attached to an exercise emotionally because you love it. I'm with you, man. I love the bench press.
Yeah.
But do I need my Karen, middle-aged housewife, bench press? Hell
mind.
No, I don't. And it, the, you know, that same line of thinking transfers over to athletics, no matter where you're working. That is the art of coaching, in my opinion, is being willing to adapt. So everything you said, I'm like, preach, brother. Yeah. I just love it. So now you did mention the things that you like to do.
Yeah.
You're an accomplished powerlifter. Transition has been like, man, from freaking track athlete, elastic, bouncy, to moving into this world where you didn't even touch an iron weight for an extended period of time.
I'm telling you, man.
And now you're just absolutely crushing it.
So, there's been a few transitions. Like you said, I was a track guy. At one point in my track career, I actually had to stop bench pressing because I was gaining too much weight.
I've never had that problem.
I was like 180, like trying to long jump, and it's like, no, you need to be like 165, you know, 170 at the most. And, you know, sure enough, like I stopped benching as heavy, so I didn't need this huge chest, you know, for college. For me, benching made me grow,
right?
And as a long jumper, you want to have this like big lower body, tiny upper body.
Yeah.
You know, you just want to have that ratio at least. Or at least that's what I found. And anyways, so I went from, you know, more of like Olympic lifting, I guess you could say. More for, you know, I'll go into Olympic lifting later. But when I look back on it, I could have dedicated my time so much better if I wasn't Olympic lifting. If I was doing some of the weighted plyometrics, some of the contrast training that I've seen arise, you know, later as I've gotten out of college, if I would have known some of the things I know now, working on, you know, certain isometrics, certain things that I know would further increase the integrity of my joints and my elasticity and things like that, versus just saying, hey, do power cleans, this will help you jump.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I look back and I'm like, man, those guys could have gotten it right.
Yep.
They didn't, you know. Did I improve? Yeah, I improved. But a lot of that was just me refining my skill as a long jumper. I don't think it was, and I started squatting more weight. I think just getting stronger at squats did more than Olympic lifting ever did for me. I think if I would have dedicated my time to learning effort, like some of the dynamic effort stuff we're going to do today, if I would have done that kind of stuff, would have increased dramatically month by month. It would have been like measurable, you know, gains.
Yeah.
So anyways, went from the Olympic lifting background. When I got, you know, I was going through my ACL recovery. So I guess I bridged back into strength and conditioning. But this was with Heidi at the time. So I was, how many months was I post-surgery? I guess I was like 6 or 7 months post-surgery. So, ACL, that's still fairly new. Gosh, that's a tough injury to recover from.
Yeah.
Especially like when they graft your hamstring. That's what they did for me. So, like the hardest thing was like gaining that hamstring strength back. Take a piece of it. I was going into strength conditioning with her and learning a lot of the postural restoration, corrective exercise background, and some of the things. So I was doing strength conditioning with like a corrective exercise, strength conditioning major, corrective exercise minor kind of thing. So that's kind of how I was training at that point, which I'll tell you, that really opened my mind to the dynamics of like posture and, you know, positioning and things like that. And a lot of that stuff I've taken forward into my powerlifting career. So went from that to, I tried to get back into my running and stuff like that. It's like, man, you know, maybe I can maybe get back into it. Yeah. And I was like, I don't really want to do this anymore. You know, yeah. So I got a membership at Gold's. I met Kayla, and I started doing some bodybuilding stuff. And, you know, I was kind of exploring maybe doing a bodybuilding show. And then I got to Villa Sport. That's when I really started going straight into bodybuilding. You know, where you're focusing more time and attention, you're more volume, more internal focus, rather than, you know, as an athlete, we're trying to move weight as efficiently as possible without any lag in time, where bodybuilding, it's like move weight as inefficiently as possible.
Right.
Make it as hard as possible.
Yes.
So, like, that was a big switch in dynamics right there. Did bodybuilding for about 3 or 4 years. And then I was like, you know, the thing I always realized is, like, I look good on stage. I won a few contests. But I didn't really ever see myself being a professional bodybuilder, nor did I really want to. And I really got down and thought about it. It's like, I don't want to live my life, like, eating chicken and rice forever. You know, and just constantly being miserable. Like, yeah. I mean, some people can make it fun. Some people manage to deal with the suck and of not eating, you know, as much food as they would like, or the foods they would like, or being able to go out and have a vacation at any given time because it interferes with their meals and training. I can do that with what I do now.
Yeah.
So I went, decided, you know, I looked on stage and I was like, you know, I look better than all these guys, but I know for sure I'm stronger than every single person up here. I can outlift all you. So, like, I was like, let's try powerlifting. Or no, it was actually, it's like, let's try strongman. So I did strongman. I did my first strongman contest, which I always thought strongman was like the quintessential, like, if you're strong, do this.
Yes.
Right? Because, like, it's like, take this awkward object, pick it up and lift it over your head. Yeah. Like, it's like caveman meets the rock.
Exactly.
You know, like, yeah, I don't care. Like, yeah, there's some technique that goes down to it, but a lot of it's just outright strength. And that was something that was always fascinating, is that every contest is a little different. So I did that, and I just realized that, you know, 5'9 is not going to do well in strongman. So I would have probably done pretty good at, you know, pressing events, because I didn't have to press very far. But no one really cares about the middleweight strongman competitor. They want to see Hathor.
Right, Brian Shaw.
Brian Shaw and all those 100-pound monsters. So I was like, okay, well, I've always had a really strong squat. I've always had a really good bench press and deadlift. Oh, not deadlift, but deadlift. I had a good power plate. So I had to learn, you know, the deadlift. I had to learn how to not pull it like a bodybuilder. You know, bodybuilder, you're going to have more of a true hinge pattern. I had to really, really work on that. Treat my deadlift more like a press, more learning some of the different dynamics of a deadlift. Squat was never a problem. I've always been really good at squats. I squatted throughout all of college. Never did deadlifts though. We did power cleans, and that, you know, that was one of those things. I was like, I wish I would have been doing deadlifts.
Yeah.
Maybe, even if it was like with a hex bar or something like that, I wish I would have been doing them, because I think I would have gotten more results out of a hex bar deadlift against like bands or something like that. Power cleans. The catch position just throws me off. Like, why are we having to catch the bar?
Yeah.
You know, like,
yeah.
It was just one of those things. Oh, is it like to work on your I don't know, your ability to stop weight from moving?
Yeah.
Like, I can do that with just like a depth jump, you know, or something like that. Mm-hmm. It always, like, I saw so many like wrist injuries and things like that from that, so I never liked that. So anyways, went from strongman, and I was like, well, let's try powerlifting. So I did my first powerlifting contest last year, and sure enough, went in there and walked away with a state record squat, my first contest. This is my calling. So I'm gonna do this. I mean, I was 216 pounds and I totaled 1808.
Wow.
So I mean, yikes. I had like a 503 Wilks, like, for my first meet. People were like, there's people that train their whole life to get a 500 Wilks.
Yeah.
So I was like, well, let's do this.
Yeah.
And I just had a powerlifting contest a couple weeks ago, and I totaled higher. Wasn't the meet I wanted, but you know, sometimes in powerlifting you have injuries happen. I had an injury. You know, we start with the squat on the powerlifting meet. I strained my quad on my second attempt with 705 on my back, and it was a slight strain. I knew it when it happened. I felt it, and I tried to push through it, but it was just, you know, whatever happened, it didn't allow me to push through that little sticking point. And if I would have been able to, it probably would have been even worse. So it was probably a good thing I didn't get it, but you know, all the things led up to this meet, with all my athletics and bodybuilding and just like all this like mental fortitude, just like mental strength. Being smart is one thing, so I was smart. I scratched my third attempt, but I was in a lot of pain. You know, I could barely put weight on my left leg, but I still found a way to finish the meet.
Yeah.
I ended up benching a PR of 451, and then I went for the state record, which I attempted 469, and I would have gotten that. I got held for an extra 2 seconds. I think. So they said the bar didn't stop, but it did.
No.
Yeah. So I was sitting there like, hey, it's time to go now. But anyways, I was lucky. I was warming up for bench because it was up near like the outside of my hip,
uh-huh,
like that vastus lateralis insertion right there, and man, it hurt so bad. I was worried I wouldn't be able to even get into my bench arch.
Yeah.
And sure enough, went and started warming up. It was fine.
Yeah.
Like, okay, we can deal with this. Deadlift, I was like, it's gonna be tough.
Yeah.
Deadlift's gonna be tough. But sure enough, what I did, I took my wrist wraps and I wrapped them as tight as possible around my thigh and compressed it and just walked around with that. It's like, because I've used like voodoo floss in the past, and it's always done really well for me if I had some swelling or something. And sure enough, like, that got me, that kept the swelling off long enough to where I could deadlift.
Wow.
So,
went up
and make it happen. Yeah, went up, smoked my opener, and then smoked my second attempt, which was a 683. And just, it was the fastest sets I ever moved, and I went for 705. I lost positioning a little bit, I'll be honest, but a lot of it was like right there at that lockout point. The squat just, it gave out, the left one did, gave out on me. Got the shakes, couldn't push through it, but you know, considering I had a quad strain,
yeah,
being able to finish that meet was pretty great.
It is.
You know, and still be able to PR, got best lifter, but I just know that the potential in powerlifting is there. Like, at any given meet in the next 8 months, I could go out and total 1900 and be the best ever in this organization.
Well, you know, what I know from you and the time we've spent together, and just, God, I guess we've known each other close to 3 years now. I know you're a competitor.
Yeah.
You're a competitor. And, man, I still am, you know, and I can relate to that, man. So I'm happy you found something you're not only good at, but mm-hmm, you know, you get out there and compete. It's just awesome.
Probably could have been good at bodybuilding, and just, you know, I didn't find it as much fun.
Yeah.
You know, some people love it. You know, some people, that's everything they live for and stuff like that. I'm an all or nothing person. If you're telling me that bodybuilding's a 24/7 gig where you have to be all in on it, I'm going to be on my heels.
Yep.
I'm going to be timing them 2.5 to 3 hours, you know, apart. I'm making sure I'm hitting my cardio. I'm going to be in the 2 hours for my weights and another hour for cardio. My whole life is going to be consumed by that. For someone with my personality, it's probably not the best choice.
Right. You try to keep the marriage afloat.
Yeah.
Get all the way.
Right, stuff like, I like to go fishing on the weekends.
Right.
So,
right. I get it. Well, you know, I know you've got a general outline of some of the stuff we're going to do today. You mentioned earlier, you've got a little dynamic effort lower body for me today, and with a little emphasis. I've got some weak quads. So Tyler's going to help fix that problem. You can probably tell that's not a weak point for him. So, Tyler, thanks for taking the time.
Sure, man.
I really appreciate it. Yeah. It's been a great talk.
Thank you. I normally do for... See, I'm a big advocate of, like, having really strong feet. That's like, whenever you see me working out, I'm usually barefoot.
Yeah.
I am a big advocate of, like, strong feet. So we're gonna work on your feet a little bit before we start.
Okay.
That thing weighs, like, 50 pounds. Yeah, like, for the body temperature.
Yeah.
Alright, so curl myself forward.
Oh wow.
A little harder than it looks.
It's
right?
Hard. It's hard. You have a race.
You gotta do the length of the mat.
Oh my god.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Ah! You can tell my feet are a little stronger, right?
Yeah, that's wild, man. That is wild.
Oh my god.
You'll feel like all the way from the bottom of your feet all the way up to your calves. And it's one of those things, like, you have foot problems, and you can do this at your house.
Yeah.
You know, every day. Just do, like, one side of the mat, and then do that, like, every day.
God, I feel my calf like crazy. Oh my god.
Your knee issues, back issues, always start, I think, at the feet.
Yeah.
Man. I used to do, like, you know, like a 2 to 3 second hold.
You're trying to go back a little deeper neutral. Each time.
Yeah. I'm not, like, a big static stretch guy. Like, I sometimes do it after, you know, working out if I feel tight or whatever. Normally, I just try to let my weights do the stretching for me. I try not to make my warm-ups exhausting.
Yeah.
But, like, right to that point where if I did a few more sets, it would probably smoke me. Just enough to get the blood flowing, get the joint moving. So, we've done the ankle. So, this one's a little bit for knees and shins. You've probably done these reverse.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so.
Oh, man. It's been a while, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm not very good at these. I try to be. Just leaning back, keeping the glutes squeezed. And I have to support still. Yeah. So what I'll do is I'll put my hands right here on the thighs.
Uh-huh.
And then the big focus is, like, butt being squeezed.
Uh-huh.
And your pelvis being forward.
Uh-huh.
And ribcage trying to stay down as much as possible.
Oh, yeah.
And then just pushing down with your feet.
Okay. Like through the top of the foot.
Yeah,
ankle.
Through the top of the foot. That way. Yeah. My adductors actually get pretty fired up on these.
Yeah, I feel that.
Like that.
It's like a little more glute focus that way?
Yeah.
Ooh, yeah. So you're just bouncing in and out?
Yeah, I just kind of push diagonal. Trying to, like, separate that hip joint.
Yeah.
Okay. I got a lot of glutes, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. I need this stuff. Movement's medicine, motion's lotion. So what we're gonna do is go and bring his spine and bring his lower back through its natural range of motion through using the reverse hyper. Now, what I'll normally do is, like with Tim, is I'm not gonna throw like loads straight on. That'd be like me just like telling him just to go squat with weight all like all at once and first. While some people may be able to do that, other people cannot. So what we're gonna do, he's gonna work a 3 second up, 3 second down tempo on the reverse hyper, and we're just gonna look at his spinal, his lower spinal column, and make sure it's moving with the correct mobility. All right? All right, now completely relax and let all of this just separate. Okay, feel separation here?
Yeah, oh yeah.
Okay, so as you come up, we're gonna use the cue of driving his belly button into the pad. And he's gonna do it in a 3 second motion right here. So drive your belly button into the pad, and then your head is gonna follow your legs. So all this is gonna mirror your legs.
Okay.
Okay? All right, and nice and slow. And then 3 seconds down. And you can see there's separation. And go again. 3, 2, 1. Now it's together. This is exactly how you want your reverse hyper to look. And down. And he could probably even get a little bit more retraction in his upper back. So on this one, try to retract your rhomboids a little bit more. Okay, so he's in retraction here. That's good. A lot of people, you know, we're doing the lower back, but the upper back correlates with lower, so he's retracted. As he comes back down, he falls back into protraction, where this can be spread. All right? So now, as he goes into extension, goes into retraction, now we can get the whole spine working as one. This is a very slowed down version. This is just to make sure his body knows exactly what we're gonna require of it before we go into a sped up version of it. So on this one, you don't get a lot of traction. You don't get a lot of traction here because we have no weight pulling his legs forward, but we will. Now that the muscles are firing correctly, that we've taken the time to put tension on each range of motion of the spine, now they're warmed up correctly. So it's like doing a tempo squat before you start getting like heavy on your squats. Work the tempo, make sure that each range of the motion, each range of motion is getting adequate tension. You see a lot of people warm up and they're always like bouncing. There's always that question. It's like, what's the best thing for your training? Well, the thing that's missing. If it's like a movement like this that you're just always swinging on, well, there's time under tension that's missing. There's tension that's getting lost. So just do it on that first set, you know, get everything contracting correctly, and then now we can put some motion to it. Just gonna do an easy set of 10 here, and we're just gonna basically do the same thing we just did. It's gonna be a little more sped up, and his legs are gonna try to swing forward now. So he's gonna try to see his feet in front of him at the end range of this. Now you're gonna relax on the eccentric now.
Okay.
Relax on the eccentric. Let your spine move freely. Spine moves freely. Nice.
Oh, that's sweet.
Yes. So now instead of creating tension on the eccentric, he's allowing his body to relax and move through the movement. Now we can get more range of motion at the bottom. Get more flexion at the bottom. Good. We need to work on abdominal bracing now.
Okay,
so something I always teach is like, before I teach a squat, I need to be able to teach you how to create pressure. You probably already know this, but for you guys, we'll show you a way that I've done in the past that really works well.
Okay.
All right, so we're just gonna lay on our back. Okay, and the thing we're gonna do here, lift our legs straight up, okay? So what I'm gonna do is put my hands right over here. My abs are sore, so this is gonna hurt. Alright, so I'm gonna put my abs right over my belly button. Okay? Now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna work on breathing in and then breathing out. See how I lift my hips like that? So like as I breathe in, I create pressure. As I breathe out, my hips come up. So what I'm doing here is I'm rotating my pelvis essentially. There's many other ways to work pelvic tilt. This is one that I just find that's very easy. And there's you get a lot of feedback from it. Like, your abs will feel this. And that's how, before you squat, how that should feel. It's a press, so like, I'm inflating my lower back, I'm inflating my abs. That's how you create pressure against your belt. All right, so Tim, do it now.
Going arms here?
No, put your hands over your belly button.
Okay.
So I want you to feel your inhalation and then push, keep this down.
Okay. Oh.
And all you need to do is inflate your lower back so that your hips rise.
Okay.
That's exactly how it should be when you squat. Good. Now treat it like a squat brace. So down, breathe in, and inhale. And then as you push, don't exhale yet.
Okay.
Push. There. And then down, down.
Good. Yeah.
I'm going to do 10 reps like this. So, like, for all of you at home, you warm your lower body up for squats, right? Why not warm the only limitation of a squat up as well? Your ability to squat heavy weight is not derived from your legs. It's all right here. You see someone fail a squat, they don't fail with their legs. They usually lose their gut. And then push and plate that lower back. Good, there you go. Everybody thinks abs, but we're pushing here, here, and the lower back.
I can feel it.
Yeah. And that'll get you sweating too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good God.
Woo!
So now,
our next step is proprioception. One of the toughest things I found in squats, at least with the heavier loads, is the walkouts. So one thing I always do is I do a couple sets with the tsunami bar before we squat. And it's just good, you know, I'm not a big Bosu ball guy. I use it to sit on for a box squat, but besides that, like, I don't really use unstable surfaces. I like unstable objects on a stable surface. This makes a little more sense to me, so that's what we're gonna do next, all right? So, this is called a tsunami bar. You don't necessarily need one of these. Like, it's nice because it's a little more bendy, a little more unstable, but you can do this with a regular barbell. It's called a hanging kettlebell technique. All right, here you go. The way I do this, double, like that.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
And then put it on.
Yeah. All right, just wait a second, because this thing will move.
Oh, same time.
Yeah, same time.
Need partners for
what
this.
What ring do you want it on?
The outside ring.
Got it.
So, Tim is going to implore all the things that we had done up until this point. Alright, so as far as activation, so mostly for him it's going to be his feet and his core. So when I teach a squat, I teach bracing first and foremost. It's going to go from the floor up. Alright, so floor, core, bar. Those are my three steps. Alright, so my first cue is going to be creating pressure through the floor right away. All right. Next one is going to be my breath in. I'm tight. I lift up. Now I have pressure pulling down on the bar. So my upper back is completely stiff and tight. Okay. I'm trying to contract, trying to break this bar over my back. And then I'll walk back straight. Step, 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 step. Alright, so that's a good walkout. You can keep it under four steps. It's a good walkout. Right here, we're going to take our breath in. Think about what we just did on the floor there. Inflating our lower back. And don't come up with like a true dynamic effort because this thing will fall off.
Okay, alright.
But yeah, just staying tight. Working on trying to keep this as stable as possible.
Okay.
We're going to do 10 reps here.
Oh yeah.
Remember we were learning with our toe walks?
Yes.
Create pressure like you were doing toe walks.
Got it.
There you go. Good. So Tim's doing more like a traditional high bar or like a front squat. What we're gonna work on is, excuse my French, opening your taint, okay? As Ed Cohn would say. So Ed Cohn, one of the best powerlifters of all time, gave his cue. From the side, we shouldn't think of knees first, we should think of taint first, right here. So we sit down here.
Got it.
Not knee driven.
We'll go a little wider then.
Yeah, it's fine.
Tank, baby.
There we go. Now we got the hips.
Woo!
Yeah, nice. Looks like three more. You see how good his arches are now? He's pushing down with that big toe and driving through the outside portion of his heel. So we're creating this cross section. Pressure here, pressure here. Good. What I saw on Tim is that I'd like to see him get better about like sitting. It's almost like sitting in a chair. So allowing his body to sit back into his hips a little bit more. This is strictly a squat for strength, so let's be clear on that. This isn't me teaching a squat for Olympic lifting or anything like that. It's not a high bar squat, anything like that. This is how I squat for strength.
Okay.
All right, so from right here, we want to draw the rib cage down, inflate the lower back, obliques, and the rectus abdominis. So all of this here is tight. If I was to elevate, this muscle can't be shortened.
Yeah.
Right? So I have to find this happy medium between chest up and rib cage down. Very tough to do. I say lift your chest, people will elevate the rib cage, right?
Yeah.
So we gotta find this happy medium of keeping the rib cage down, rectus abdominis engaged, obliques, and lower back inflated. But what I can do is I can drop my shoulders. You see how that elevates my chest now? From that point, I can sit back, and not feel like I'm getting tilted forward.
Okay.
So, this stays the same. Draw those shoulders down.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. You want me to hit it on the earthquake one more time?
Yeah, one more time.
Okay. I'm gonna go wider with my grip. One time. Bar a little lower too.
Yeah.
Yep. That feels tight.
Look straight ahead though.
Okay.
Yes. Good. One more rep. Yeah, nice, good, all right.
Really good. Yeah.
So basically, we've achieved what we needed to achieve. Understanding our body in space and mastering the tool we're gonna use, all right? So we're gonna do a little different. We're gonna actually use a safety bar. It's gonna be a little more front-loaded for him. It's gonna challenge his upper back a little bit, so we're gonna go with that. All right.
Let's do it, baby.
Fine.
That looked great.
Yeah, it looks good.
Yeah.
All right, cool.
Open butthole on the Bosu, baby. Butthole to Bosu.
Okay. All right, so the reason I started adopting the Bosu ball is I see so many people just plop down to the ball or to the box. That's not a box squat. A box squat needs to have some control to it. It's not about smacking the box and then coming back up. But even if someone did do that, I would have some forgiveness here, all right? And if someone's gonna mess up, I'd rather it be in a better situation than this. So
right.
What we do, what I do with the box squat, I set it up close to the ball, and as you look, when I sit down, what I cue people on is slowly absorb into the ball. Okay, so from here, it shouldn't be that I smack onto the ball. It should be that there's the ball, absorb, go.
Get out.
Quick. Yeah. Okay, because that's going to carry over much better to a regular squat, in my opinion. If you try to just plop down a regular squat, you're going to just lose it. Your head straight ahead. Think about like pulling your chin back in your throat. There you go, that's better. Yeah, much tighter. Good. And give me some more speed off out of the hole this time.
Got it.
Here we are, we absorb and then speed. Go! There we go, that's good. One more.
Alright,
good.
Woo! Love that.
Yeah. Feel like a rocket.
Yeah.
Let me grab my red band. So here,
okay.
We'll do single band. I don't get much out of that, so
okay.
We're gonna do double. We double the band. Like this. Pull down. And you're set.
See if I make it look as good as you.
Yeah. Oh god. There we go. Alright. So we're gonna do three reps.
Okay.
Three reps. Keep everything the same.
Okay.
So this is quite a bit of band tension, as you'll see. I put your whole body into it.
Nice. Awesome.
So good thing to do when dealing with this much band tension is like as you lift up, push forward into the rack.
Okay. Own it before.
Yeah. Yeah.
See, pull it back.
That's crazy. Okay. All right. Okay. Oh yeah, here we go. There we go. Alright, here we go. Create tension, floor or bar. And blow it up! And go! One more. Go! Nice. Walk forward. Good. All right, so this is where we establish how much band tension I want to use today, which is just pretty much a shitload. So, what we're gonna do next is we're gonna work it around in between. What I usually do is like in between 35% and 55% is like where I kind of like to stay.
Okay.
All right. Normally I'll stay right at 50.
Uh-huh.
As I, like say if I'm in a taper for a meet or whatever, I might take it to like 55 or something at some point.
Okay.
But I feel really, really good at 50% bar weight, and the rest I just ace in the bands, ace in the tape.
Okay.
So that's what I'm gonna do to you.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
What is your
back squat?
So, this is not a back squat.
So let's go conservative. Let's say 315 for the safety bar.
For back squat?
No, for back bar. Squat. It's probably closer to 335 right now.
Okay, so I would actually cut you down about 50 to 60 pounds from that.
Okay.
So let's conservatively say like 275.
Okay.
All right?
Okay.
We'll do a little calculation.
Math. Time for math.
Remember in the 90s when the teachers were like, hey, you're not always going to have that calculator on you.
Gotcha, bitch.
Yes, I do. If I can find it. All right, here we go. So, 75 times.
135. So, okay. let's go the quarter first.
Okay.
All right, and then we'll go.
Let's go. We got three?
Yeah, three. Trying to explode off of that ball as hard and as fast as possible. All right, here you go. Get your tension. Inflate that whole abdominal cavity. Here we go. And go! Not that. A little wider stance. Okay, sit back. There we go, there we go, there we go. Drive! Nice, one more. Forward. These be your fastest set.
Okay, let's fucking do it.
Come on, I want you to jump through that floor. Let's go. Jump through the ceiling. Here we go. Big air. Got it! There we go. That's it. Stride down. Come on. Stride down.
That was it. Let's go.
That's the stimulus we need right there.
You know, keeping you healthy, it's imperative that you do this stuff.
Yeah.
The lighter weights with the higher band tension. That's personal opinion.
Right.
I've done a linear program before. I've gotten tendonitis. I've had all kinds of breakdowns.
Yeah.
With this, I train intense, I train heavy, and I never really break down. So, there's something to it.
Yeah.
So, deadlift. Give you some of the cues. A lot of them are very similar to squat, actually, which is kind of crazy. So we're gonna start with rooting ourselves, and the bracing is very similar. All of your bracing, when it comes to the stuff we worked on with squat, applies with deadlift. It's the same muscles that are supporting the spine, so still gonna brace the same way. Your stance is going to depend on the person most of the time. People with longer femurs might have to go a little bit wider with their stance from what I've seen in the past. But your bracing is still going to be the same. I'm going to do an over-under grip with you. That's what I usually teach. Hook grip, if you work it for a while, it's a far superior grip. I got tiny thumbs, so it didn't work well for me. Anyways. So from here, what we're first going to work on doing is feeling your lats. So watch Tim, and I'll show you what we're working on here. So if Tim is above the bar, before we even start, you want to be able to feel your lats. So if he's just relaxed right here, right, what we're going to have to do, what we're going to try to tell him to do is reach down. And you should feel his lats right now. I feel them right here on him. So that's a big cue. It's like a lot of people, they think deadlift, they like squeeze your shoulder blades together.
Yeah.
That's not the right cue. You know, you want to drop them as much as possible. That's how you get your lats engaged. So that's something you want to feel before you even get over the top of the bar. All right. So once you feel that, then you can address the bar. Okay, so from right there, what he's going to want to do is straighten his legs all the way, breathe into his belly, and then as he drops his hips, he wants to get his chest up right there, okay? And this is called wedging yourself into the bar, and I'll show you exactly what it means. Dropping your hips on a deadlift is nothing if you're not, like, wedging yourself into the bar. So what that means is as I drop my hips, I should be almost lifting the bar up by the pressure I'm creating upwards with my chest. So from right here, from this position, if I press down, guess what happens?
Yeah.
My shoulders rise. If I just drop my hips and press down, guess what happens? My hips shoot back.
So we want to be in a good position to, like, when we go to press the floor down, then our shoulders rise up. Our hips don't move back or up. We go straight up with the bar. Okay. Yeah, go, press. So you see his hips move back just a little bit there? Okay, so just keep in your mind, Tim.
Yeah.
Simple cue, shoulders rise and lower hips.
Got it.
Yeah, there we go, that's it. So the deadlift is a leg press. The deadlift is a hip thrust. We're pressing down with our legs and trying to accelerate our hips through the bar to break the bar. So press down, hips forward. That's all we want to see. The hips should never go back at all or up. Shoulders go first, then hips shoot forward. Hips, boom, there you go. See that bar pop? So if you ever watch me deadlift warm up, it'll look like this. It's real aggressive, pretty violent. So from right here, that's the hips just driving into the bar, trying to break the bar with your thighs. That's the way. Let's go to 185. Tim, approach the bar. Little things go a long ways in the deadlift. All right, so grab the bar, get in your ready position. So when I look at this right now, he can move his hand slightly inward on each side. And what that would do is if I get 2 inches here, 2 inches here, guess how much higher that would be,
ooh,
right? So as a taller athlete, look at there. Now wow, what I got. Now, yes. Now, as a taller guy, he has more leverage on a deadlift than I do as a shorter guy, his longer arms. So from here, he can get his chest higher in a higher starting position. So whenever he goes to load and explode, he's here. And all he has to do is lock his hips right there in a contest. All right? It's about efficiency. Let's go single here.
Okay.
Lighter weight is the same way you should treat the heavy weight. It's all the same. You should always attack your deadlifts with confidence. This is not a time when we discuss the cues and stuff like that, and I'm first coaching someone through the warm-ups and through the lighter weights. That's a time where we refine things. From there on, as a coach, you only give one or two. I'm even hesitant to give two cues. I usually say one thing at a time. You notice before he pulled, what did I tell him? Shoulders, hips. That's two words that imply two different things that are very important about the lift.
Those are really thick bands.
Oh, she's thick.
Yeah. Treat it the same, man.
I will.
Just, you know, yeah, the biggest thing is, you know, press down and accelerate those hips forward. At no point do I want you thinking about pulling the weight up.
Got it.
Press the floor down, shoot the hips forward.
Got it.
Okay?
Got it.
Yeah! Accelerate them. from about here to here. It was slow, and as soon as it got here, it accelerated.
Okay.
All right. Good. All right, now it's just bodybuilding stuff.
Before we even got started, it's like powerlifters miss on things, bodybuilders miss on things, right? So now we're trying to, you know, bridge those gaps as much as possible. We've done what it takes, what we need to do to increase our squat, right? We need our dynamic effort method. The next squat session for me would be like a max effort, you know, emphasis. So, but in every session, I'm always doing hypertrophy work in some capacity. And those help drive my main compound lifts the most, I think. You know, if I just squatted all the time, if I just deadlifted all the time, just bench all the time, I would have certain weaknesses arise. You know what I mean?
So, squat. Deep arch.
That's a big, big no-no on this one. You want to keep your pelvis neutral on belt squat. Especially because the belt's pulling this way. You're just gonna pull you more into hyperextension. Alright? This isn't a strong squatting position anyways. I don't know why people squat this way. You're just making all of this a marshmallow. Okay? Keep yourself stacked. And this is a good way to practice that. The other thing is relying too much on the equipment. Sitting back like that and then coming forward. You wanna have fingertips on the belt squat and have your weight over your legs. Boom, straight down, okay? Something that I really think is very beneficial that a lot of powerlifters could take into account is you don't need to do more sets, okay? You think bodybuilder, lots of reps, right? Or at least in good bodybuilding, lots of reps, as few sets as possible, okay? Powerlifting's like as few reps as possible for many, many sets, right? So where we want to try to fall in line is with the best of both worlds. I want to get as much stimulus as I need, but not break myself down.
Yeah.
Okay? So on this one, we're going to do 5 reps and just like feel the weight. Get our nervous system ready for what this machine feels like. Tim's never been on this machine. All right? He doesn't know that this and this are completely different.
Yeah.
I can load 12 plates on this. I can load 4 on this. So we're gonna just see how 5 feels for them at a tempo of a 5-second negative. And then we're gonna work towards an all-out set. One all-out set. That's all we need. Alright? There we go. Better. Good. Lock the hips to the top. Don't just get crazy. They're locked now. Good.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
I like things when it comes to like hypertrophy, working up to things like drop sets, working up to rest pauses, things like that. These are all concepts that I've taken from my bodybuilding time and imply, put this into the power building kind of programming. I don't need to do 10 sets of 10. I don't need to do 4 sets of 10. I need one all-out set where my legs get pushed to their absolute max. That's what I need. That elicits growth. So Tim is gonna work up to a heavy 8 to 10 reps. We're gonna rack, let him catch a few breaths, and we're gonna repeat it for a drop set.
Okay.
All right?
Okay.
Same execution as last. Yeah, nice. Good. As much effort as you can give on the negative. There you go. There you go. Good.
goes into the more effective than doing four sets of 10 or three sets of 10. So basically the same premise as the belt squat. That's your high intensity training. It's high intensity, low volume training popularized by Dorian Yates. So a lot of the things I do in bodybuilding, I like that Dorian did, because Dorian lifted heavy. He was strong, but he also had some of the most muscle mass of any bodybuilder on the planet. So I look at the greats, I look at people who've done it before me, and I like his methodology on training. Give everything you have into that one or two sets. You don't need to do a whole bunch of sets. On speed work, yes.
Yeah.
There's always exceptions to the rules. I get my sets in on the skills I need to improve on. Comes the muscle growth, you just need to give effort. All out effort. Kind of pull it on up.
Okay.
Some cues for leg extensions, because not a lot of people really talk about cues for leg extensions. You want to use these handles and pull yourself down into the seat. Same cue, can't shoot a can from a canoe. So right here, pull yourself down the seat. The only joint that moves is my knee joint.
Yeah.
Boom. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Full flexion, full extension. All right. So one cue you can think of is, you know, pull yourself down the seat. But as I extend my leg, I'm not thinking about what my knee's doing. I'm thinking about driving my hamstring as hard into that seat as I can. So think in terms that way.
Okay.
Okay.
All right.
Let's discuss. This is not a strength exercise.
Okay.
I mean, I guess it could be, but it's like, where do you want to apply that?
Yeah.
You know, for today's purposes, this is not a strength exercise. This is a neuromuscular re-education exercise, if you want to call it anything. This is hypertrophy. This is contracting through the movement. So our objective isn't to be efficient here. When I was talking about like things that bodybuilders are good at, things that powerlifters are good at, this is where we want to be really sucky at powerlifting. Right?
Yeah.
We want to be really good at bodybuilding. So what we want to do is think about contracting the muscle through the movement. So driving the hamstring down, thinking in terms of how much tension can I create through the entirety of knee extension. That's what we want to think about.
Okay.
All right?
So this time, like three. Two, three reps.
Okay.
Just slow it down through that fully flexed position right here. So you're here, you're full flex. Contract right through here. Contract. There you go. Now go. There it is. That's it. Okay, 1 to 10.
Oh, that was like an 8 or 9.
Okay, so we found our weight. Now we can begin the set. You guys will find that if you take this method of hypertrophy and apply it to your training, you're gonna see so much more muscle growth like than you ever have. And you're technically doing less work, right? So you can stimulate to a very, very high capacity and then feed the machine. That's how you grow.
All right, Tim, this is gonna suck. All right.
All right, here we go. Get ready to go to the dark place.
Got it.
All right, come on. Two more. Here we go. Contract. Move except your knees. Come on, up. There it is. Come on now. Drive. Good. Drive. Three more. Two more. Come on, let's go. One more. Just to my hand. Ready? 10 reps. One. Down, lower, three. Come on, right here, right here to my hand, right here to my hand. Three more. Three, two, one, done.
Handshake curls is driving your hips into the pad.
Yeah.
Okay, you want to make sure you do that. We're going to curl up. One, two, three, four. Up. One, two, three, four.
Okay. So 5 second negatives on these.
We're going to do 10 to 12 reps here.
If I can get there, if I can get there.
This is a very heavy hamstring machine.
10 pounds.
It's not the same as your 10 pounds on Life Fitness equipment. Ooh. Like, this is really heavy.
Oh my god.
What? I was cramping at night from these. I was cramping like 2 nights ago.
So everyone here is huge.
Alright, there you go. Ready?
Yeah.
And pushing Tim all the way. Lower. And lower it.
There you go. Good. All right.
So that's probably going to be one of those exercises. Probably 2 sets would be good.
Quad workout I've had maybe ever.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it wasn't like anything fancy.
No. Just good technique and work harder.
I always look at like joints and muscles. It's like, all right, so this is what they do. How can we maximize it?
Yeah.
You know? I don't think in terms of like what looks cool on Instagram, you know? Although it gets more views.
Right.
If I just put this workout on Instagram, get a couple views.
Yeah.
But not like if I was doing some kind of like heels elevated landmine single leg squat or something.
Right.
You know?
So. Yes. Yeah. Tyler, thank you so much, man.
Man, anytime.
I really appreciate your time today.
Yeah.
My legs are going to hate you for this.
You'll have to come back and train back with me. I have some real
good stuff. Oh, I'd love it. Yeah. Absolutely. Invitation accepted.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Hey, thank you.
Yeah, of course, man.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you guys for watching. That's been a dynamic effort day with Tyler Williamson at Legacy Barbell. Follow him on Instagram at TW Strength and Performance.